أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم Lesson number 111 سورة التوبة آية number 123 يا أيها الذين آمنوا O you who have believed قاتلوا Fight Against who? الذين يلونكم من الكفار Those who are adjacent to you of the disbelievers وَلْيَجِدُوا And they should find فِيكُمْ in you غِلْغَةً Harshness وَاعْلَمُوا And you should know that أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ That Allah is with those who are righteous. Over here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the believers. As we know that with these ayat, we are nearing the end of Surah At-Tawba. And from the beginning of Surah At-Tawba, various instructions have been given as to how to deal with the disbelievers, how to deal with the hypocrites, how to deal with the enemies of Islam. First of all, the command was given, fight against them. Why? The reasons were also explained. Over here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us as to how this task should be prioritized, how this work should be done, in what order. Should the Muslims randomly fight any enemy who comes their way? How should they fight against the enemy? The instruction is being given as to how this task should be prioritized. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قَاتِلُوا Fight against who? الَّذِينَ يَلُونَكُمْ يَلُونَ is from the root letters وَاو لَامْ يَا And what does wali mean? To be close. And tawali is when two or more things come after one another. Two or more things when they come right after each other, and they are of the exact same type. Meaning nothing that is other than them comes in between. So basically, wali, wilaya, tawali, all of these words from this root, what meaning do they give off? Of closeness. Of closeness. That nothing else is in between. There is nothing else that is in between. So, الَّذِينَ يَلُونَكُمْ What does it mean? Those who are close to you. And this has been understood in two ways. First of all, those who are close to you, meaning in distance. In distance. When it comes to borders, the enemy that is nearest to you, that is closest to you, in geographical location, that is the enemy that you should fight first. And then think about fighting the enemy that is distant, that is more far. Do you understand? In geographical location, which enemy should you fight first? The one that is closer to you. Because only when you have dealt with that enemy, then you will be able to deal with the enemy that is far. If you leap onto the enemy that is far, then how will you deal with the one that is close to you? If all of your energies are going towards the enemy that is far, then the one that is near is going to attack you and is going to cause you a lot of damage. So fight against that enemy which is closest to you. Secondly, it is said that يَلُونَكُمْ gives the meaning of those who are at your level, those whom you are capable to fight. Not that there is an enemy of yours much stronger than you, you are unable to fight that enemy, but you say you're going to go fight that enemy. If you do that, what's going to happen? You're going to end up harming yourself. So قَاتِلُوا الَّذِينَ يَلُونَكُمْ مِنَ الْكُفَّارِ Fight against that enemy, min al-kuffar, from the disbelievers who are closest to you, because the most threat is also from them. The second instruction that is being given over here is that وَلْيَجِدُوا And that they should find. Who should find? The enemy should find فِيكُمْ in you غِلْضَةً Harshness. The word غِلْضَة is used for harshness, toughness, strictness in behavior. It does not mean that you should become rude and oppressive towards them, unjust and biased towards them, but what does it mean? That you should be firm and strict when dealing with them. Get the better of you in every situation. You should not succumb to everything that they demand from you. Stand up for yourself. وَلْيَجِدُوا فِيكُمْ غِلْضَةً They should find in you some kind of strictness. Not that they can always come and harm you and demand things from you and you're always listening to them, always willing to please them, compromising on your religion, compromising on justice, on the welfare of your people. No. Be firm and strict with them. Stand up for yourself. Don't become cowards before them. they should find some kind of strength in you. They should not have the guts to harm you. وَلْيَجِدُوا فِيكُمْ غِلْظَةً. وَاعْلَمُوا, and you should know, that أَنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الْمُتَّقِينَ, that indeed Allah is with those who are fearful of Him. Those who have the taqwa of Allah. Allah is with those, meaning His help, His support is with such people. So as long as you have the fear of Allah, as long as you obey Allah and refrain from His prohibitions, remember that you will have the help of Allah. And the moment you abandon taqwa, you will be abandoned by Allah as well. You will be left to yourself as well. So in this ayah, the instruction with regards to the order of fighting against the enemy is mentioned. And this instruction is, this command is of al-awwal fal-awwal. That deal with the one that is first, then the one that is next. Al-aqrab fal-aqrab. Deal with the one that is closest, then deal with the one that is second closest, second nearest to you, and so on. Because it does not make sense for a person to not deal with that which is before him and leap onto things that are farther away from him. Now this ayah does not necessarily mean that the believers are to fight the disbelievers that live near them, even though there is no battle that is required. So basically this is not necessarily meaning that go and fight against them offensive battles. What this means is that when there is a need to fight, when there is a threat from the disbelievers, then who should you fight first? The one that is closest to you. And we see that this is exactly what the Prophet ﷺ did. If you look at it, when the Prophet ﷺ was in Medina, it wasn't just the people of Mecca who were waging war against the Prophet ﷺ. It was also the people of Taif who had expelled him brutally. Before he migrated to Mecca, we know the famous incident as to how the Prophet went to Al-Taif and how the people, they chased him out of the city. We know of that incident very well. Similarly, we also know about how later on, after the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, what happened, that the Prophet ﷺ sent letters to Rome and Persia, but they were not welcomed over there. And the ambassadors of the Prophet ﷺ were killed. Did the Prophet fight Rome and Persia? No. Who he deal with first? The one that was closest. And who were they? The mushrikeen of Mecca. And we see that the Prophet ﷺ, he fought the idolaters first, the Meccans first, then the people of At-Taif, and then so on and so forth in the Arabian Peninsula. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him control over Mecca, Medina, Taif, Yemen, Yamama, Hijr, Khaybar, Hadramaut, and other Arab provinces, then the Prophet ﷺ went on dealing with who? The Romans as well as the Persians. And we see that after the death of the Prophet ﷺ, during the caliphate of Abu Bakr radhiyallahu anhu, Rome was finally conquered. And during the time of Umar radhiyallahu anhu, what was conquered? Persia. It wasn't just that, okay, these Romans, they are being hostile towards us, okay, let's go wage war against them. No, if they did that, then what would happen? The mushrikeen of Mecca would come and attack the Muslims, and that would be it. The whole matter would be finished. So, in this ayah, a very important principle is being taught to the Muslims. And this principle we can apply in everything that we do in our lives. Everything that we do in our lives, we can apply this principle. That how should we prioritize our work? How? Do that which is first. Do that which is closest to you. And if a person applies this principle, only then he can be successful. Because in this manner, he grows gradually. The circle spreads outwards gradually. And only then he can be successful. Like for example, we learned that when doing da'wah, the Prophet ﷺ was told that who should he warn first? His family members. It wasn't just that go and invite strangers to Islam, people whom you've never spoken to, people who don't know you at all. No. In Surah Al-Shu'ara, ayah 214, we learn, وَأَنذِرْ عَشِيرَتَكَ الْأَقْرَبِينَ, and warn your closest kindred. Warn the closest members of your family first. Similarly, in Surah Al-An'am, ayah 92, what do we learn? وَلِتُنذِرَ أُمَّ الْقُرَى وَمَنْ حَوْلَهَا. أُمَّ الْقُرَى, meaning the city of Mecca, the mother of towns, and then وَمَنْ حَوْلَهَا. So he was to start from Makkah and then spread outwards. Similarly, when it comes to giving sadaqah, what do we learn? So many times where sadaqah has been mentioned, where charity has been mentioned, whose haqq comes first? فَلِلْوَالِدَيْنِ The parents, وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ Meaning when you want to spend, when you want to give generously, then who should you give first? The parents, the relatives, and then so on and so forth. Similarly, there are many people amongst whom we live. But whose right is the most? The neighbors. Right? And even if there are several neighbors, then whose right comes first? The one whose door is closest to you. So this principle should be applied in everything that we do in our lives, that whatever we have to do, how should we prioritize the work? Deal with that which is closest. Deal with that which is most urgent and most important. You may have heard of time management tips in which they explain about divide your tasks according to urgency and importance. If something is urgent and important, do that first. Isn't it so? If something is urgent but not important, then delay it a little bit because it's not that important. Similarly, if something is not important, not urgent, delay it as much as you can. But what should you deal with first? That which is urgent and important. So start with the closest. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذَا and when? مَا ever. إِذَا مَا whenever. The word مَا has several meanings in the Arabic language. Sometimes it gives a meaning of mausul, that which. Sometimes it gives a meaning of istifham, what. Sometimes it gives a meaning of nafi, not. So ma has several meanings. And ma is also used as za'id. What does za'id mean? Extra. So in other words, it does not carry any, you can say, specific meaning. It cannot be translated in the context. It is extra why to give the meaning of emphasis. So idha ma, whenever, anytime. Every time that unzilat, it is revealed. What is revealed? Suratun asura. Every time a surah is revealed of the Quran, فَمِنْهُمْ so from them. From who? From the hypocrites. What do they do? There are some who, مَنْ يَقُولُ who says, to who? To others who are like them. So there are some among the hypocrites who say to others who are like them, that أيكم, which of you, زادته, it increased him, هذه, this إيمانا, in إيمان. Whose level of إيمان has increased since we read this surah? It didn't increase mine. Did it increase yours? No. It's the same stuff, repeated over and over again. There's nothing new. It's so boring. This is what the hypocrites would say, in mockery of the Qur'an. And this was a way in which they used to criticize what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed. In order to belittle the commands of Allah, in order to belittle the revelation, what would they say? Whose iman has gone up since we read the surah? And discourage one another from accepting the commands, from following the commands. We see that in the Quran, especially this surah, Surah At-Tawba, what is it called? Al-Fadiha. The one that exposed and humiliated the hypocrites. So every time some ayat were revealed, what would the munafiqeen feel? That they are being exposed. And in order to make up for that, in order to hide that in some way, they would begin to belittle the Quran. They would begin to belittle the revelation. And they would say statements such as, أَيُّكُمْ زَادَتْهُ هَذِهِ إِيمَانًا. What does Allah say? فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. As for those people who have believed, فَزَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا, then this surah has increased them in iman. Why? Because they already have iman. And those people who don't have iman, then obviously their level of iman is not going to increase. The munafiqeen, they don't have iman in their hearts at all. They have imarad, they have kufr. So definitely when the Quran was revealed, when another surah was revealed, their reaction would be, my iman has not increased. Why? Because there is no iman. But the believers, because they have iman, what happens to them when they learn something new from the Quran? فَزَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا. It increases them iman. وَهُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ. And they become happy. They rejoice. They're happy about what? They're happy about what they have learned. That now they have another thing to do. Another way to earn the pleasure of Allah. Another way to do something good. وَهُمْ يَسْتَبْشِرُونَ. They rejoice. They're very happy about it. So we learn from this that the Quran, it does not necessarily benefit everyone. This does not mean that there is a problem with the Quran. What does it mean? There is a problem with who? The people. For example, sugar is normally good. People like it. And if people avoid sugar all the time, it could actually make them very tired and their blood sugar level low. So what are they told? Have some sugar. Eat something sweet. Get some energy in yourself. However, some people, if they're given sugary food, it's going to negatively affect them. Sugar is natural sugar. Even if it's just in some kind of fruit, it's not going to suit them. Why? It's because of the illness that they have. Similarly, the munafiqeen, they have an illness. They don't have iman. So no matter what they are told, no matter what part of Quran is informed to them, it does not increase them in good at all. In Surah Al-Isra, Ayah 82, we learn, وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ وَرَحْمَةٌ. For who? لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. For the believers. And we send down of the Qur'an that which is healing and mercy. For who? For the believers. وَلَا يَزِيدُ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا خَسَارًا. But it does not increase the wrongdoers except in loss. Those people who do zulm, the Qur'an only increases them in loss because of their lack of iman. وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ. But as for those people in whose hearts is a disease. What disease is this? Weakness of iman. The disease of hypocrisy, of doubt, of unbelief, of jealousy. Those in whose hearts is a disease. What happens to them? فَزَادَتْهُمْ. So increase them. رِجِسًا. In filth. إِلَى رِجِسِهِمْ. To their filth. Because they are already filthy inside. Therefore, even when the Qur'an is poured into their hearts, what overtakes, what overpowers? The filth. وَمَاتُوا. And they die. وَهُمْ كَافِرُونَ. While they're disbelievers. So we see that those people who believe, every time they learn something from the Qur'an, it benefits them. Every time they learn something from the Qur'an, they benefit from it. It draws them closer to Allah. It makes them more active in trying to obey and please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They want to do more. Their desire to learn more increases and to do more increases. But on the other hand, those people who don't believe, nothing helps them. Rather, with each dose, they get worse. With each dose, instead of getting better, what happens? They get worse. So it shows that the disease that they have is so vile, it is so evil, that even if good is put in their hearts, vile, this filthy disease, it overpowers. That the best provision even cannot benefit them. For example, if you have a pitcher, a jug that is full of water, and it's clean, perfectly clean, you just filled it from the filter, the color is nice, it doesn't smell bad at all, it doesn't taste bad at all, and you have two glasses. One glass is clean out of the dishwasher. And another glass you take out of the dirty sink. And perhaps somebody had milk in it or something else in it. Now you pour water into those two glasses. Is the result going to be the same? No. In one glass the water is going to be clean. In the other glass, what's going to happen? The color is going to change, the taste is going to change, the smell is going to change. Are you going to say there's something wrong with the water in the pitcher? No. It's the glass. It's the container. It's about what it is that you bring forth. What is it that you have to receive the Qur'an? If the heart is clean, if the heart is good, then the Qur'an will benefit. But if the heart is not clean, if the heart is not good, then the Qur'an will not benefit at all. Similarly, if you look at it, when it rains, There are different types of lands, isn't it? Perhaps in your garden, in your backyard, what's going to happen with the rain? Your grass is going to become even more green. Your flowers are going to begin to bloom. And there's going to be beautiful fragrance everywhere. But at the same time, that same rainwater, if it falls on a garbage dump, what's going to happen? Is it going to smell good? Or is it going to smell bad? It's going to spread the nasty smell everywhere. So is the problem with the rain, or is it with the land? It's with the land. It's with the container. It's with the heart. So the believers, they benefit from every ayah of the Quran. But the hypocrites, what do they think? This didn't benefit me. Even this surah didn't make any change in my heart. This is nothing new. It's the same stuff being repeated over and over again. أَوَلَا يَرَوْنَا. Do they not see? The hypocrites, do they not see? Don't they get it? That أَنَّهُمْ, that indeed they, يُفْتَنُونَ, they are tested, they are tried. فِي كُلِّ عَامٍ, in every year. عَام is from the root letters عَيْن وَاوْ مِيم. And the word عَام is used for year. There are other words as well that are used for years. عَام is also one of them. So these hypocrites, don't they see that every single year they are tested, they are put in difficulties, مَرَّةً, one time, أَوْ مَرَّتَيْنِ, or two times. At least once or twice, every single year, they are tested. They are put in difficult situations. ثُمَّ لَا يَتُوبُونَ, but still they don't repent. وَلَا هُمْ يَذَّكَّرُونَ, nor do they take any lesson. They don't repent, they don't change their ways, nor do they take any lesson from what they have experienced, from the fitna, from the difficulty that they have gone through. Yuftanun. Yuftanun is from the root letters fatanun, fitna. And what does fitna mean? A test, a trial, a difficult situation. So they are tested every single year, at least once or twice. How? In different ways. It could be a disease, it could be some financial loss, it could be a situation through which their hypocrisy was exposed. For example, we learned that when they constructed the masjid of Al-Dirar, what happened? Their whole plot was exposed, wasn't it? That was a fitna. Similarly, on their way back from Tabuk, they said some really inappropriate things about the Prophet ﷺ, about the Muslims as well. But what happened? All of their statements, they were exposed. Similarly, they attempted to kill the Prophet ﷺ. Weren't they exposed? They were. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking that don't they realize that every single year, at least once or twice, they are put in a difficult situation, their hypocrisy is exposed, their plots and plans, they're exposed, they're made to fail, they're reprimanded, but still they don't repent. They don't change their ways, they don't feel bad, nor do they take any lesson from what they have gone through. We see that each and every person, this ayah is specifically about the hypocrites, however this is in the general sense as well, that each and every person, he goes through some big problem at least once a year. Every single person. For example, a car accident, a health problem, a very serious illness, or an illness that is just never comes to an end. Similarly, loss of a job, fire in the house, a natural disaster, robbery, vandalism, a person loses a loved one, similarly some financial loss, a big traffic ticket, rejection letter. People go through many difficulties, and at least one or two big difficulties at least once a year, every single person. Now this does not mean that every time a person goes through a difficult situation, that means he's a hypocrite. No, this is not true for every person. The fact is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends tests our ways all the time. Every moment is a test. However, there are at least one or two big tests at least once a year. Why? Why does this happen? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send our way some big test? For different reasons. Firstly, in order to shake the person. in order to make him realize that he must do something. And when a person goes through a difficult situation, when a person goes through a trauma, then what happens? If there is any good in him, it comes out, it comes forth. For example, a person never realized he was patient, or he could handle a difficult situation, that he could do with living with less. Generally, we don't think of these things at all. But when we are put in a difficult situation, then we realize, okay, I can actually do this. For example, recently, in our house, what happened was that there was no hot water. And because it was the long weekend, nobody could come and fix it either. And we're like, how is it possible? It's winter, it's extremely cold outside, and there's no hot water. How can you survive? How can you even wash your hands? How can you cook in the kitchen? How can you do anything? But then we realize that we can actually do with using less water as well. It's possible. We just handicap ourselves. We just think that, oh, this is not possible at all. But when we are made to go through these difficult situations, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us realize that we can make do with less, that we handicap ourselves, we make ourselves dependent on things, and we can actually survive on less. We can do that. Who said you have to have a shower for 10-15 minutes? You can do it within 5 minutes. Who said you have to take 10 minutes to do wudu? You can do it within literally a minute. When you have to do it with cold water, when you have limited hot water, then you realize your capability. So when we are made to go through a difficult situation, what happens? The khair that could be within us, it comes out. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes us see what we are capable of doing. That how we are holding ourselves back. Secondly, another reason is that to make a person realize that perhaps he has done something wrong. Perhaps this is a consequence of his own wrongdoing. And that he needs to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He needs to fix his habits. He needs to be careful about what he says. He needs to be more grateful for the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him. The basic necessities of life that we're so used to. We're so used to them. We cannot imagine life without hot water. But then when we don't have it, we realize even this is such a huge blessing. Such a huge blessing. And there are so many people in the world today who don't even get to touch hot water for days. They don't get to even see it for days. So when we are made to go through difficult situations, it makes us realize that we need to be more grateful for the blessings that Allah has given us. Perhaps we're not that grateful. Perhaps we're being ungrateful. Perhaps we have done something wrong. We learn in Surah Al-An'am, Ayah 42, that وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَىٰ أُمَمٍ مِّنْ قَبْلِكَ فَأَخَذْنَاهُمْ بِالْبَأْسَاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ لَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَضَرَّعُونَ. That certainly, we send to nations before you, meaning messengers. But then when they denied, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? We seized them with hardship, with difficulty. Why? So that they would become humble. So that they would become humble before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would reflect on their actions. And they would think, what is it that we're doing wrong? We need to seek forgiveness. We need to turn to Allah. And many times it happens when everything is fine, when people don't face any problems, they are not grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And all of a sudden, when they're hit by something, they realize, maybe I should make dua. Maybe I should pray to God. Maybe I should think about Allah as well. Maybe I should think about Quran as well. Many times it happens with people, that when they're hit by something, then they think of praying. Then they think of reciting the Quran. Then they think of making some dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah makes us go through difficulties so that we become humble. Over here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the hypocrites that no matter what kind of difficult situation they go through, they don't take a lesson. They don't repent at all. They don't change. So we need to check ourselves over here. When we go through a difficult situation in our lives, a big test, what is our behavior? What is our reaction? Do we become indifferent? Do we become heedless? Or do we reflect on our ways, on our actions? Do we begin to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Do we become more grateful for what we have? Or do we constantly complain? There is a hadith that is reported in Abu Dawood, in which it has been narrated that when a hypocrite when a munafiq, when he becomes ill, and then he is cured. So he was ill, and then he is cured. He is like a camel, which has been tethered, which has been tied, and let loose by its owners, and does not know why they tethered it, why they tied that camel, and why they let it loose. The hypocrite does not reflect on his life, on the events of his life. He does not take a lesson. He does not realize why he was made to go through a difficult situation and why he was taken out of it, just like a camel who does not use reason, who does not have any idea as to why he was tied up and why he was released. No idea. So the true believer, no matter what happens in his life, he reflects upon it and he takes a lesson from it. وَإِذَا مَا, and whenever, أُنزِلَتْ, it was revealed, سُورَةٌ a surah. Whenever a surah is revealed, what happens to the hypocrites again? What do they do? نَظَرَ, he looks, بَعْضُهُمْ, some of them, إِلَى بَعْضٍ, to others. They exchange glances. They look at one another. And what do they communicate? Through their eyes? That هَلْ يَرَاكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ, is anyone looking at you? Can anyone see you? هَلْ كَانْ يَرَاكُمْ, he sees you, مِنْ أَحَدٍ, anyone? Can anyone see you? If nobody is seeing, if nobody is looking at us, then let's get up and go. Let's escape. Nobody will notice. ثُمَّنْ صَرَفُوا, then they go away. صَرَفَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ, may Allah turn their hearts. بِأَنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ, because they are a people who do not understand. This ayah has been understood in two ways. First of all, that وَإِذَا مَا أُنزِلَتْ سُورَةٌ, whenever a surah is revealed, a surah in which is the mention of hypocrites, of what they have done, of their plots being exposed, their fadiha, what happens? Because the munafiqeen, even they would come to the gatherings of the Prophet ﷺ, because they had to show they were believers. So just imagine the sahaba are sitting, the munafiqeen are sitting. The munafiqeen, what would they do? They would look at one another. نَظَرَ بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَى بَعْضٍ, they would exchange glances and they would signal, هَلْ يَرَاكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ, was anyone looking at you? Meaning when you said such and such, when you did such and such, did anyone see you, that now they have come and told the Prophet ﷺ and now he is reciting ayat about us? In other words, who told him that we said this? Who told him we did this? Did you? Did they? Who told him? And this happens many times. It happens many times because the Quran talks to each and every one of us. And sometimes it happens that perhaps somebody told the teacher as to what happened with me and now she's talking about me indirectly. And look at these people, they're so dishonest, they go and tell about everything. But the fact is that the Quran is about everyone. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses each and every single one of us. So the munafiqun, what are they concerned about? Who saw you? Who heard you? Who told him that we said this, we did this? هَلْ يَرَاكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ ثُمَّنْ صَرَفُوا, then they turn away without taking any lesson. They turn away without taking any lesson. The ayat are revealed. They are being addressed. What they have done is being discussed. They are being taught a lesson. But instead of taking lesson, they just get stuck on who told the Prophet ﷺ. How come he found out? They don't take a lesson, they go away. What does Allah say? Their hearts have been turned. They don't take a lesson at all. They don't understand at all. Another way of understanding this ayah is that whenever a surah is revealed, and in that surah, there is a command which they dislike. For example, in the context of the munafiqeen at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, a command to spend in the way of Allah, or a command to go out in the way of Allah for jihad, a command which they disliked, a command which they did not want to observe, they would look at one another. They would exchange glances of fear, of denial, of rage, of hatred, of aversion. That, oh, can you imagine? Would you believe it? They just stare at one another out of exasperation, out of shock, that now even this we have to do? Even this we have to follow? نَظَرَ بَعْضُهُمْ إِلَى بَعْضٍ, they look at one another, they exchange glances of denial, of detestation, of mockery over what is in the verses. And then They look at one another, communicating that, هَلْ يَرَاكُم مِّنْ أَحَدٍ? Can anyone see you? Can anyone see you right now? Okay, nobody's looking. Let's get up and leave. So if nobody's looking at them, they immediately leave. ثُمَّ انصَرَفُوا. Then they get up and they leave. They depart from the Prophet ﷺ's gathering, having no interest in what is being taught, in what has been stated in the Qur'an. They have no interest at all. They want to escape. And they just want to make sure that nobody's looking at them. They forget that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basir. He is watching. He is looking. They're only concerned about the eyes of people. Because a hypocrite in reality is afraid of who? People. He wants to please people and he is afraid of people because he is a people conscious person. هَلْ يَرَاكُم مِّنْ أَحَدٍ ثُمَّ انصَرَفُوا صَرَفَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He has turned their hearts away from guidance and belief. Because they have no interest. They don't even try to understand. When they have no interest, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to force it upon them. بِأَنَّهُمْ قَوْمٌ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ. Because there are people who do not understand. Now generally, people communicate with their eyes, with their glances, when something is mentioned that is common between two people. Isn't it so? When something is mentioned that is common between them. So immediately they look at one another and just with the look, they exchange an entire conversation. If it's about something good, it is okay. But if it's about something that is bad or inappropriate way, that is not permissible. That is not permissible. Especially in a gathering of ilm, where the Qur'an is being learnt, where the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is being learnt. In that majlis especially, it is not correct that people are communicating with one another, whether in writing, by passing notes, or by text messaging, or by nudging one another, or by looking at each other. This is not correct. Because the gathering in which the Qur'an is being learnt, in which the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ is being learnt, that gathering is a sacred gathering, and it should be respected. Because if a person does not respect, then he will not be able to receive. If we don't give adab, then we will not be able to gain anything. So it is part of observing proper etiquette that when we are in the majlis where the Qur'an is being learned, then we must refrain from communicating with one another unnecessarily. Actually, we'll listen to the recitation of these ayat, then we'll continue. Create. That a person leaves the gathering in the middle for a reason that is not that important, for a reason that is not that necessary. For example, if a person really needs to go, get up and go urgently to the washroom, that's okay. That's a different case. Similarly, if there is a mother whose child is crying, that is also a different case. Who needs to go attend to her child, that's another case. However, just unnecessarily, I'm getting bored, let me just go see what's happening outside. This is not appropriate. This is not correct. Because we learn later on in the Quran that the gist of the ayah is that it is not proper when the Prophet ﷺ and the believers, they are involved in an amrin jami'in, when they are together working on a collective matter, when everybody is doing something collectively, then it is not proper that a person just gets up and leaves. Because if he does that, he is going to miss out himself, first of all. And secondly, he is also going to cause distraction for the other people. Similarly, when we're talking with one another, we are going to miss out on what is being taught, and at the same time we're going to cause distraction for other people. So these two things we must become careful about now, inshallah. Now that we know the etiquette, that no unnecessary communication and no leaving the class unnecessarily either. Okay? Inshallah. Because once we have learnt, then what should we do? We should try to implement. If you look at the first ayah that we learnt, in which the Prophet ﷺ and the believers are commanded, Ya أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, that fight against who? The enemy that is closest to you. And also they should find in you harshness. And at the end, who is mentioned? Muttaqeen. So we see that taqwa does not just mean that a person should be lenient and soft in every situation towards everyone, no matter what they have done. What does it mean? That where there is a need to be strict and firm, a person is firm and strict for the sake of who? For the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because he is more fearful of Allah than he is fearful of people.